I proposed that I would do something that is do something today that is taken from my class that I've been teaching 15 years, which is reading Capital and getting students to read it and paying attention to the problem of what it is to read this book by this old bearded guy from 150 years, nearly 150 years ago. A piece of technology that is as old as the ticker tape. You know that machine that prints out the stock prices? Although, of course, now in instantaneous capital and the speed of the stock market exchange, the ticker tape is completely digitized, electronified, and runs across the bottom of your television screen rather than exists in a room. Gayatri Spivak made the point that if we had a ticker tape in this room running stock prices now, if we could supply enough paper for it, it would fill the room in seconds because of the volume of global trade. Okay, but this is an old piece of technology, this book, Das Kapital. And my students, undergraduates at first, and then MA students, quite often had not read Capital. I want to do a no guilt trip routine here, but just a pop quiz question. How many of you have read Das Kapital? Cover to cover. All of the footnotes. All of the prefaces. The three different versions. The second and third volume. The three volumes of surplus value, the theories of surplus value, and all of the prefaces by other people and introductions and all of the commentaries and, yeah, nobody can, right? That's why it's a little mental exercise. But I want to address this a kind of a question or something that's interesting to me, which is that before anyone even comes to read Capital, or even when you read it again, there's already an immense weight of interpretation, history, various social experiments that took it as a blueprint for the good society or so, hedging, prejudice, guides to reading. I've listed some of them I just grabbed off my shelf recently and just took a photograph on the floor with my camera, so it's not a very good one, but you know, reclaiming Marx's Capital and using it effectively, a guide to it, and so on. And my condensed argument is something like, roughly every 10 years we are presented with a hegemonic new reading of Capital. And we can debate actually who and what belongs to each decade, okay? Lenin in the 1905-1918 period, maybe Lukács in the 20s, I don't know, you can debate. Bataille in the 30s, just to be provocative. Sartre, the 50s, Althusser, the 60s, Sweeney, the 70s, later Derrida in the 90s, I want to talk about that. Because that's interesting to me as well, and who knows now? I think it's a battle in the English language, at least, between Harvey and Jameson is winning. Eagleton is gone, and he's took the money from Manchester. Anyway, so I want to convince you that it's interesting, at least, to read this book again, and to think about the politics of reading it, okay, and also to pay attention to issues of reading and translation. Now, I wondered if anyone might have brought a copy of Capital, especially one in which language? Terrific, excellent. I'm excited by that. And English, okay. And which edition?
It's, I think, Encyclopedia, the time, yes.
Oh, cool. Excellent. Is that the abridged version? You know, there's this Oxford...
Sorry, thin.
Small print. Okay, that's also problematic, isn't it? It's also problematic in the size of the print, but there's an Oxford University Press abridged edition. That's good. I'm glad we've got the Croatian version, because I'm going to get into specifics. I start with the students by saying, well, let's begin with what's at hand, what's immediately at hand, and think about that. There are prefaces and so on, but there's also kind of apocrypha, if you like, or epiphenomena. The dedication, for example, to William Wolfe. William Wolfe was a comrade of Marx and Engels from the New Rheinische Zeitung, the newspaper that Marx was an editor. He was also an editor of this in Germany and in Cologne, and they were becoming radicalized in the period of 1847, 48, up to the uprising then, the so-called June days, just before, just after, Marx and Engels produced the Communist Manifesto. So William Wolfe was an editor of this newspaper that was becoming more and more political and controversial, and eventually was closed down by the Prussian state. They published their last edition in red ink and fled the country, pretty much. Marx then from Brussels was drafted with Engels to produce the Manifesto of the Communist Party for the amalgamated communist groups, the Small League of the Just and the Communist League. And they said that they will produce this manifesto, as they were required to do it, at a meeting in London in November, December 1847. And then Marx went to Brussels to write it, and he hadn't delivered it by late January. The League of the Just then threatened him with expulsion or worse if he didn't deliver, and in a very quick period he produced this text, which, if you read that, I mean, you can quote from it, I'm sure everyone can, is a kind of fast written but brilliant evocative and campaigning text that it is. And it was circulated in Germany, and with a synopsis version, a list of 17 demands that Marx also had printed off to be delivered with the manifesto in February, March of 1848, which he paid for with money that he'd got from Engels. And I think Wolff contributed as well. Wolff was a benefactor for Marx as well as Engels, which we all know a lot about. Engels gave much money to Marx to keep him going. But Wolff paid specifically, and why I'm talking about this and why I think it's the dedication at the beginning of Capital, is that it was when Wolff died in 1864, 3 years before the publication of Das Kapital, Marx was able to then take the inheritance money that he got from Wolff, a dedication in his will, to pay for the printing and to carry the manuscript in 1867 with him to Germany to have it published. Anyway, that's getting ahead, but as an illustration of why I think it's worth paying attention to the epiphenomenal parts of the text, you know, the dedication, the prefaces, what's in the prefaces and so on, because, yeah, they are the first. Should they be privileged? We could ask this question. They are the privileged forerunners of this weight of interpretation before you actually open the text and start to read, which is what I want to get us to do eventually, but you know, it might take some time to get there. Let me perform this anyway. There's this hesitation before we read. Right? There are four prefaces. That seems excessive. Right? But of course, why are there four prefaces? That's a slip that needs to be analysed. Why are there four prefaces? Because there are different versions of the text. We should start then by raising a question of what is the text, the right one to read. Because if you're reading four prefaces and you know there is the preface to the first German edition, the preface to the first French edition, the preface to the second German edition, the preface to the fourth German edition, third and fourth German editions. Well, and we could also include the preface to, if you're reading it in English, the preface to the first English edition. And of course, then there is Mandel's, in the Penguin anyway, the preface. No, let's not get onto Mandel yet, and I can make denunciations of international Trotskyism later on. These are the privileged guides to interpretation, so let's spend a little bit of time with them. Can we do that? See, I kind of want to, there's this contradictory thing. I want to clear away all the baggage that is there before you can start reading, but that's not going to be possible, is it? Because of course it's always there. It's like if you visit a city, you already have a guidebook, you already know about the city a little bit from history or movies or some. There's a rumor abounding before you get to any city that's well known. In a way, this is contradictory. You can't just turn up. You already come with expectations and or prejudices. And some of the prejudices about Marx, of course, are powerful. This figure that belongs to a scholarship and politics, the most influential social scientist there has ever been. Is that controversial enough to say? But the most influential book there has ever been, except for the Bible and the Quran. Can I say that? Am I being insulting to Darwin's Origin of the Species, the interpretation of dreams, the second sex? Well, I think not, really. This book is one you have to read, right? You have to engage with it because of its social science, because of its politics, because of its influence, agree or not. But that's already a prejudice, and I've not been able to put it neutrally, and you can't. That's a problem, and at the same time, I kind of think I want to try and read the text anew every 10 years, or every time. I read it every year, but this is a contradictory task, but still, let alone the history of Marxism, Leninism, the Bolsheviks, and the Council Communists, and Stalinism, and Luxembourg, and Liebknecht, and the Maoists, and the Althusserians, and all the guides. We'll get into this. Right up. It seems like there is one version of doing the history of social science which could be glossed as different ways to read Marx. Right? The Foucauldians, Deleuze was allegedly writing his own version of how to get into Marx. The greatness of Marx, the grandeur of Marx is his unfinished, and I don't know whether the manuscript will ever emerge, if there was one, book on Marx that he said he was writing. The prefaces, what do we get in the prefaces? The privileged, right? The ones that Marx himself writes. Right? He says some very interesting things about his approach and the kind of reading he wants us to make of the book. Right, this is 150, nearly 150 years ago. In 3 years' time, it will be 150 years, the anniversary of publication. Right, but he was writing with an implied reader in mind, with a certain readership in mind, which was the German Social Democratic Workers' Party cadre. Okay. He's writing to Spivak says this to try and give them the X-ray vision to see through the trick of commodity capitalism. I think maybe it's more than that, but that will be teased out. But it's interesting. She also says about this implied reader that any reader of this text has to presume themselves to also be the implied reader. If we take up the book, We adopt the position ourselves of saying in a certain way that this book is written for me to read. So we are the implied readers as well, not in Marx's intent. Well, maybe so some sense he wanted this book to remain as an irritation for the bourgeoisie forevermore. Yeah. So he imagined far-off readers in time. He actually talked about the bourgeoisie regretting that they'd ever caused him his angry carbuncles that put such ferocity into his text. That was in a letter to Engels, I think he was joking. But the letters to Engels are also a kind of preface to the book. Right, I'm bringing them in now as another way of guiding a reading. It's almost this impossible avalanche of material beforehand. But Marx is saying to his implied reader, he expects, he hopes, he looks for a reader who is, first of all, willing to learn something new. That's 150 years ago, but what is it for us to be told this in a preface? That the author of this book is looking for someone who's willing to learn something new and to do the work themselves. Right? I think that's pretty key, that this book is written to provide the implied reader, the German Social Democratic Workers' Party activist, with the skills to learn something new about the organization of contemporary capital at that time, but also now. And that for me means this book is not an empirical description of how things are, but a kind of set of unfolding tools that are presented abstractly, if you like, as Lukács says it is, and they unfold a set of tools and resources that can be deployed to make sense of the condition of capital. And that changes as time changes. And how we do that is up for discussion in all of these prefaces and commentaries. Marx also says a little bit about what the style of the book does and what to expect in the prefaces he wrote. For example, he kind of explains his writing and, in fact, rewriting process as having, he uses the word coquetted with Hegelian language. Coquette, you know what that means in English? So to flirt like a dancing girl with Hegel. Fantastic image, right? That big, serious Hegel and his flirting with Hegel. And also that the analysis differs from the mode of presentation. I wondered about that for quite some time, and I'm thinking there that what's at stake in that is that it may be that the analysis and the order in which the presentation unfolds are not the same thing. Like, you might, as an experiment, ask this question, which is to get ahead of ourselves a little bit. I want to get to the book. Do you see that urge there? I want to get to read to talk about the book, but I'm still in the prefaces. But might be, why does he start with commodities? I mean, does the analysis begin with commodities? Or is it the presentation that puts commodities at the beginning? In the third preface that Marx writes, the second preface, the preface to the third version, if you like, the second German edition. Marx mentions Kugelmann. Kugelmann had also been involved in the Neuranische Zeitung. He was corresponding, he was living in Germany, and Marx was talking, he was encouraging Marx to finish this damn book, right? You know, the public is waiting. Whether or not the public was really waiting for this book is a little bit hyperbolic. Right? It didn't sell well. It took a long time to really become a hit. You know, it didn't. The first print run was slow. But Kugelmann is saying, you know, get this book out. And when his book came out, it's interesting later on, I think Kugelmann suggests that his wife wants to read the book. Wants to read, comrade Marx, my wife wants to read my book. But you know, where should she start? She doesn't want to read the whole thing or something. And Marx recommends that she start with chapter 10. Well, chapter 8 in the German. See, already I'm confused as to what the real book is. In German, the chapter The Working Day, which becomes about the struggle for the 10-hour day and about the introduction of cheaper women's labour into the factory and children's labour, is the one that he suggests that Mrs. Kugelman should read first. It was a long time ago. I don't want to get into this thing about Marx being a sexist of his time and so on. But he's thinking of his reader, right? Yeah, and she will be more perhaps interested or exposed to the nefarious and devastating effects of industrial motor production on women and children. But, you know, shouldn't Mr. Kugelman be concerned about that as well? Of course, yeah. We would make a separate critique of that and attach it to questions about whether it should be the working men's international and so on. But I raise it here. I bring it forward in a way. It's in a preface. It's not bringing it forward. Just to say again, which is the real book that we're reading? There are four prefaces because there are different versions of the text. The text published in Germany in 1867 is very, very unlike the version we are reading. I mean, there is, I think it's about 7 pages just in the first chapter that are different because we read, I mean, I also have a copy of the 1867 German, but my version here is the 4th German edition. In total, I've worked out that there's probably about 90 or maybe more pages that are different from the 4th edition and the 1st edition. And some of those pages are crucial ones. We'll talk about that. Marx had added whole sections when the text was translated and serialized in French in 1873. So in chapter one, for those of you who've read it, you know the section about the table that lifts up its skirt and dances down to market. It grows out of its little wooden brain, grotesque ideas, more mysterious than, right? From that section there through the commentary on Robinson Crusoe and so on, that's not there in the original text, right? Which I think is pretty interesting. What happened? Pop quiz again. What happened between 1867 and 1873 that made Marx think that he had to write his book differently? You know, remember, he hasn't finished Volume 2 and hasn't finished Volume 3, and Kugelman and Engels, get on with the task. But he goes and rewrites his book for the French readership while it's being serialized. It's being serialized monthly. Why did he feel like he needed to do that? How's your history? Yeah, that was part of it. That was the preface to the thing is being translated into French and comes out over the period 73 to 75 in French because of the commune. And Marx's commitment to supporting those, the proletariat's first revolutionary government, those few months of proletarian rule in France, which came immediately after the Prussian siege of the city. So he rewrites with his implied reader in mind, right? And he wants to clarify it and make it more accessible for those workers who've been politicized and mobilized by real struggles that he was involved in and somewhat blamed for in a way. Of course, many of them were executed and deported to Caribbean islands and so on. But it puts the question of which is the real book, okay? And Marx left instructions in his own copy of the French edition of which pages to include. He took the changes that he made in the French, for the French serialization, he took them and marked them in the copy of his own copy of the 1872 German edition. And it's this that Engels and Marx's daughter Eleanor Marx, after his death, gather together and they put into what becomes the 4th German edition. And so they assemble that. And it turns out they don't, there's still another 60 pages from the French edition that didn't make it into the 4th German edition, which have been published by this getting insane now? Getting a bit nerdish and obsessed with scriptural hermeneutics, right? There's the mega. I haven't even begun to talk about the mega, the Marx and Engels gesammelte Arbeit, the literary, the scholarly, huge project of producing all of Marx's texts in all of those versions, right? So it's divided into four sections. Marx's writing on capital, his correspondence, and then other versions. And so section two is going to be 15 volumes. They're all quite beautifully bound, hard bound, only in German so far, I suppose. Volumes and they've of the 15 slated for going to be published in section two, so the books on capital, the versions of Das Kapital, we've got 10 out so far. There's still five to go, and the 10th one's recently come out, well, a few years ago now, and it has about 50 pages from the French that didn't make it into the German that have never been translated into English. No, that's coming. So there's new Marx, like posthumous Marx is coming for us to... This is getting too obsessive, but yeah. Let me obsess a bit more. Yeah. I mean, it's a bit like, you know, it's the same text, but it's rewritten, and it's remorphed and changed. It's changed over time. It's changed in Marx's hands. It's changed in Engels' hands. It's changed with Eleanor's influence. And we're changing it every year. And we are conjuring with the images of it. And we're coquetting with the book, if you like, and with the table and its wooden grotesques. And grotesques is a great word for that. And Robinson is being moved about on his island, as Marx already anticipated, because Ricardo was into the Robinson story and the Robinsonades. That's a kind of storytelling trope that he has a go at. And we haven't even got to the first sentence yet. And I've only used examples so far of chapter one, although I've mentioned chapter 10 or 8, was it? Yeah. I haven't even got into the whole scheme of how Marx never finished this volume. And there's commentary. It's not on one of those books. There's a great book by a wonderfully named British scholar called Felton C. Shortall, who's not well known and lives in a small little house in Brighton. But he wrote an inspiring book called The Incomplete Marx, where he catalogues all the different schematic versions that Marx himself had for his proposed book. Right, there were going to be four volumes, there were going to be six volumes. What was in each volume changed. Material from the wages section in volume three was brought into volume one. He kind of tracks, as far as we know, the writing history of the text, and that's really interesting. But I, you know, let alone then the three volumes of historical material that were gathered together by Kautsky, who became known as the Renegade Kautsky, because he voted for war credits 100 years ago, or well, a bit under 100 years ago. We're about to have a new anniversary coming up in a couple of months. That's probably really relevant for here, isn't it? The execution, or the assassination, sorry, of Franz Ferdinand, and what that allegedly provoked, and who is to blame. Well, then, you know, this is at the time Kautsky had... do I need to get into this? The gathering up of Marx's manuscripts and the translation of his notes, I mean, his notes, that's going to be section four of the mega, Marx and Engels' gesammelte Arbeit. Right, that's going to be huge as well, because, I mean, after Capital, after 1867, so Marx lived until 1884, there's another, 17 years. In these 17 years, he wrote 30,000 foolscap pages of notes. And if you've seen his handwriting, it's tiny. You know, there's a fantastic comment somewhere where Engels says, you know, he's trying to transcribe some of Marx's commentary on Marx, and he's taught... commentary on Capital, and he's taught an assistant, to read it, but he complains that, you know, nobody can really decipher Marxist text, and it's driving him to distraction. His eyesight is becoming worse as Engels is getting old, right, living there in Chalk Farm in London. You know, this difficulty of getting the authorized text is what I'm laboring, and we haven't even got to, let's try and get to the first page. I'm going to stay at epiphenomenon for a minute, right? I mean, I think there's an issue. My German's not fantastic, but has anyone got fantastic German? But right, so I read the English, and here's my... and fortunately, it's fallen apart, a little bit damaged, and I did rip it in half once because I said to my students, well, if it was smaller, would you read the whole thing? And yeah, it's not a sacred text, right? And I ripped out the Mandel introduction in some kind of stupid Dead Poets Society, Robin Williams type moment, which I don't do anymore, but because it damages the book, and that's tragic. But after the prefaces, I'm going to use the English to talk about this. But my first thought is with the German here is Die Ware. In English, that first chapter is called The Commodity. And I think diwara is plural, is it not? Commodities. I just want to put that thought in your head that the first part of the book is badly translated into English. Right? And that's important because quite often, like big books, in literature, what are the big books? Don Quixote by Cervantes, which Marx refers to a lot, because that's part of his repertoire of metaphors and allegories and analogies that he brings in with literature, right? He's continually bringing literature into the book. It's a fantastic, it's like a, what's the literary equivalent of a bestiary? It's got, you know, he brings in everyone. There's Horace, there's Dante. The Dante bit is in the preface and in the book itself, and I'll talk about that tomorrow a little bit. Nomine Dete Fabula, something like the tale is told of elsewhere, but it's really about you. Marx uses this to say, you know, this book is about capital, the factory system in England. Yeah, I think the commodities distinction is important because quite often, like, say, Cervantes' Don Quixote, people read the first chapter and don't get through the whole book. I don't know if that's true for everyone, but since I got my copy of Don Quixote, I'd read the first chapter, it took me another 7 years to finish the thing and realize how brilliant it is when in section 2 of Don Quixote finds in a bookshop his own book about himself. And then he has a dream where he goes down into Hades and finds that the devils are playing kind of badminton with a spurious sequel to part 1 written by Alioneta, who had taken up Cervantes' text, and 10 years after part 1 had come out, because part 1 and part 2 come out 12 years apart, 10 years after, had written a short sequel using the characters from Cervantes' Don Quixote. And Cervantes obviously was pissed off in this. And he mocks and does a satire of the devil playing badminton with this spurious sequel. And also then I think partially that's why Cervantes gets ridiculously killed off at the end, right? There's no way that Cervantes, Don Quixote gets killed off at the end. No way that Don Quixote would suddenly become, you know, sane and boring. He's the great interpreter of power, right? The windmills are power. They need to be destroyed. They are the metaphor of attacking and the Pope, all of that stuff. Why would our knight of the sorrowful countenance suddenly have a deathbed conversion before he dies and, you know, end the story? Because Cervantes doesn't want other sequels, because of the copyright law. I'm getting off track, aren't I? Okay, so why I think only reading the first chapter of a text is problematic, and I want to just signal that at the start because we're only going to read the first sentence at the rate I'm going. Is that capital is not only about commodities or commodity fetishism. And it's not about the commodity. It's not a description of the commodity. Like it's a conceptual apparatus that gets the implied reader to have a series of tools and to work through abstraction so they can make an analysis of the capitalist mode of production. Right, and if you thought that it was Marxist to be able to analyze the commodity, you kind of left out the other circuits of the story. And roughly, let's say that the overall book could be, the first part, how does it go? How does it unfold? The first part is commodities. And they're almost like it's the market that surrounds the exchange of commodities. And then you go through, you pull back the curtain and enter the abode of production. And then it's how in production you achieve surplus value extraction and the valorization of that. Then there's the working day chapter and struggles. Then chapters on cooperation, on division of labor, on machinery, on training. Great section on training, right? Where he talks about it makes no difference whether a capitalist invests in a teaching factory or a sausage factory. And it's all about the production of Mehrwurst, more value, more sausage. The university has a sausage factory, I think it's just a good image, right? Given the privatization of universities in England. Anyway, and then lumpenproletariat, the reserve army of labor, the latent, the stagnant parts of the working class, and primitive accumulation, the history chapter. Let alone what happens in the subsequent volumes where circulation and crisis and credit and finance and world market unwritten exist, right? So if you thought if it was a description of the commodity and this is something like a realistic empirical analysis, kind of miss the point, the charge. But, okay, I mean the English text, I wanted to look at this first sentence. Let's start to read. Der Reichtum der Gesellschaften, it's a kind of, let me rush into it too quickly. It's a kind of quotation. It's a reference to On the Causes and Origins of the Wealth of Nations by Adam Smith, except in the, as Spivak says, in the rational prescription for the socialist society, there's no room for nations, so it's the Reichtum der Gesellschaften. Sorry, in English, the wealth of societies. So not the wealth of nations, the wealth of societies, in which the capitalist mode of production prevails, appears as an immense, I did this morning, sorry, I've done the typo in there, it should be collection of commodities. The individual commodity appears as its elementary form. Let's go back to the German. Die Gesellschaft in der Welt kapitalistische Produktion weiß herrscht, es scheint als ein ungeheure Warensammlung, die einzelne Ware als seine elementare Form, right? He's made a distinction between, individual commodity and commodities, right? And that's what I'm talking about, why die Ware is the plural and the name for this chapter. But let's not get hung up on that. I want to just stay at epiphenomenal things. First sentence of the book, in German, right? Okay. Ungeheure Warensammlung is in quotations. And it's a quotation of Marx quoting himself, which struck me as strange. I mean, people have commented on this before. Nicole Pepperell, most recently in an edited volume I did. It strikes us as strange that Marx would quote himself, to avoid plagiarism, self-plagiarism, or something, at the beginning. Except that he's quoting what he says is the first version of his masterwork of Capital. the critique of political economy, which here is in volume 13 of the German, but in the English we get the translations of Critique, the Politischen Economy, Berlin, 1859. So basically, capital has started before capital starts. In volume one of Capital, there's already existing a previous volume written 8 years earlier. Right? So it's the beginning of is not the beginning, and the end version is not the end. So I just want to this is a photostat picture of the first page of Marx's own copy of Capital. So this is the version that was found by Engels and Eleanor Marx in his library when he died. And you can see even to the end, he was again editing the text, changing it. Instead of in Belgian, whoa. He was, I think, important. He was making it more colloquial with that wo. Anyway, I'm not going to make too much of that, although I think it's significant for how we translate between the English and the German. Let me say, the second phrase there, in which the capitalist mode of production prevails, and I'm really keen to find out what the Croatian word here is for prevails, because in English, prevails really tones things down. It's not strong like Hirscht is, In Croatian, that has that sense. That's better, right? Because prevails doesn't have the domination sense. Or Hirscht kind of means rules. Her, the king, right? In which capitalist mode of production dominates or rules. It's got a regal. That's been erased in the English version. I don't know which version yours, this encyclopedia, has, because there are actually two English versions. There's the Penguin one from 1967, and there's the Lawrence and Wishart / Progress Press one from the version that we read is 1976. And that still also has prevails. The next phrase. Production by Hirscht, right? I'm saying it toned it down. Es scheint als, in English, is appears. And in fact, appears twice in the English, you see, in the second sentence. And that doesn't, es scheint doesn't appear twice in German, but that's acceptable in translation, right? To double up, because the grammar of German allows you to have these monstrously long sentences. And in English, you have to add that extra clause to remind people that you're still talking about, you know, what your subject of the sentence is. But appears is actually a bad translation for erscheint. Erscheint is this word that, erscheinung is its bigger version, it's noun, erscheinungsform. This is a Kantian, Hegelian word. It's the coquetting stuff here, right? Marx has put a marker of a certain kind of philosophical language right there. But it means something like, this is such an important word for the book. It appears all the way through the book, and it's translated in so many different ways. It can be seems, it just seems like. A seems like this. It can be is, scheint. It can be a kind of word like deprecates. It kind of reduces in some way, and several others. I'll get into. Should I be looking these things up? You can have Falschenschein. You have Scheint, Scheintnik. There's a whole series of plays on this. This is a troping word for Marx. So it's really important that we recognize that it's been put into the first sentence with a purpose, to signify Hegel and so on. And when we read it in English, and I want to know now what the Croatian version is of erscheint. What is the word here for appears You see, in German, we have erscheint aus in the second clause, right? The third line here. After herrscht, it appears as in English, erscheint aus in German.
Closer to seems.
Yeah. I don't know what is there. Okay.
I think it's quite close to it appears.
So, you have presents. So you have the Progress Press version, which is better, I think, right? A difference between appears and presents itself as, which is probably the version you have, presents itself as is good because instead of it being the wealth of societies is this immense collection of commodities, or seems like an immense collection of commodities, presents itself as more theatrical, if you like, erscheint als. It puts itself as if on a stage, but it's not. Right, it only appears to be. And further, Erscheinungsform, erscheint, then, has also a kind of shining, shimmering, spectral form. And Derrida doesn't talk about this much, but you know, it's the ghost, it's the spirit of Hegel, but also of spirit that Derrida makes a lot of in the first sentence of the Communist Manifesto, where he says, Ein Gespenst geht in Europa. That's Marx's and Engels' first line of the manifesto. A spectre is haunting Europe, the spectre of communism. Actually, it wasn't. There's probably only 100 communists at the time, like 3 months before the uprising of the proletariat. There wasn't the spectre of communism. It was the spectre of poverty and disaffection and rebelliousness, and it was massively put down. So they were not. It was hyperbolic. But nonetheless, the spectral. Is not to be missed here, because this chapter is going to end with the whole thing about the table going down to market, and it's the so-called commodity fetish, where you misrecognize relations between the price of things as, you know, that's a congealed social relation between creative human beings with labor capacity. Right, so Marx has put this in the first sentence, and it's not something just to be neutrally translated with the best word possible, but to be understood, and that takes some time. There are these three dimensions. It is, this seems like this, but it has this character of being put on a stage, and it has a spectral dimension. Let's not forget the scary or the spooky. Derrida's good at this in the manifesto, because he uses Hamlet and the scary ghost, right? This es spukt. It's spukt. And you have to be a scholar and speak to it, but that's scary as well to interrogate, right? You're a scholar, Hamlet, you speak to it. There's, right, just coming straight after the word herrscht, which is so much about power and domination, the spooky has a different tone to the English appears or presents itself. I mean, they really missed somehow the purchase of Marx's language here, especially when we get to the next, the quoted phrase, right? Ungeheure Warensammlung, which in English is immense collection, my error there, immense collection of commodities. An immense collection, I mean, immense can mean scary and monstrous, but it doesn't really carry that tone of monstrous, whereas ungeheure is monstrous. It's monstrous or even grotesque. A grotesque Warensammlung, it's not really a collection of commodities either. It's accumulated pile, right? It's not collection in the sense of, you know, yesterday I was talking about Citizen Kane. Citizen Kane collects things, right? He's not really interested in things. He doesn't even unpack them. He's interested in the exchangeability of things and their value, and because that's what a capitalist is interested in, right? Exchange, the possibilities of recouping, valorizing profit or storing it up. But, you know, this is not a collection of that. Right? The wealth of today's societies is not, appears as, but is not this monstrous collection of accumulation of stuff. And ungeheuer is a little bit colloquial. So, you know, it's monstrous for sure, rather than, well, not for sure, but I think it's better to translate it as monstrous rather than immense, because you lose that Godzilla type character to it. And Warensammlung, it should be a little bit colloquial. It should be pile of commodities. You know, a word, a grunty word, a harsh word, and not a formal, polite, nice English, you know, immense collection of commodities. That's too soft. It's been toned down. And I have worries about that, because this keeps on going all the way through the book. But yeah, I can keep on going with this, but maybe you want to interrupt me and ask a question or something.
Why do you think it's happening? Why do you think the language is softening? Do you think it's on purpose or just disinterpretation? Or do you see some trend from earlier translation to today's translation? Is this getting more evident?
Well, this is in the English, right? Which is why I'm interested to see the Croatian version, and the French version is actually that Marx himself authorized, right? Is better. Go on.
I have a comment to that question.
Okay.
It's on the topic of the implied readers that you were talking about.
Oh, can we hold this then for a sec? Because I wanted to talk just about the English translation first. There are two. There could be a better one. In fact, there's coming another one, which I can probably dig up. You know, it doesn't take Marx's own copy into account. But let me see if it's... Yeah, look, there's this website by a guy called Airbar, who is translating the text side by side. I mean, you don't need to read this right now, but let's say he's translating the two in a very handy column by column correspondence, right? So how is it changing, right? Between the Penguin edition, which is the most popular English edition, and then the abridged Oxford English edition, which should be burnt. No, let's not burn books, but yeah. It's very interesting to burn a book. Have you ever burnt a book? When the book is burning, the pages kind of burn one by one. Not many people burn books. You know? It's got a bad history, you know, burning books and Qurans and the Reichstag. Yeah, but you can burn some bad novel or something, right? Well, burn one of my books. Feel free. But each page seems to crumple. It's got some kind of scandalous charge. But anyway... between the Penguin, which appears badly translated, but still has prevails rather than Hirst, we might diagnose a simplistic political purchase, because Lawrence and Wishart were a publisher, and I say were, a publisher of the left, although in the last 2 months they have got into incredible controversy, because they have proposed to forbid the Marx Engels Internet Archive from keeping their translations on their website. And the publisher has said, we did the work, we did the labour for translating these books over the last 30 years, so we want to be able to profit from them by selling them and not have people get them for free on the internet. So Lawrence and Wishart, though, I'm saying, they were on the left and they were in a kind of alliance with Progress Press, the Moscow publisher. And so that version is better for reasons that I would simplistically diagnose as being more political. And the Penguin is it intentional? The Penguin is introduced by Ernest Mandel and translated by Stokes. And Ernest Mandel is the secretary of the Trotskyite group. They are still active. But I don't know what Trotskyite politics means to you here in Croatia, but in England we have 35 different Well, we used to call them sects, but now they're so small they're just wafers. You know, you're slicing off and splitting. Groups of five split into two groups of three, and they both bring out editions of their newspaper and battle and squabble. And unfortunately, Trotskyite politics have dominated the British scene. I would say translation is political. And, well, I'd say more. I kind of think translation is also impossible. I mean, it's horrible. It's a destruction of the text, and it doesn't communicate. It's an effort to communicate. I mean, you've got to take into account idiom, and you've got to try and translate, and you want to translate, and in fact, it communicates to people who are different, and it communicates things, and creates a new book, and can be inspiring, and actually, someone went for translation. You see what I did there? I went from being against translation to being for translation, because you have to be for both. It's contradictory, but you know. Let's go back to implied reader.
You mentioned that Marx had in his mind preferred an implied reader. Well, I have a different interpretation, and we may call it Popperian interpretation. But I believe that Marx believed that we finally discovered on how things operate, how the world history operates. He believed that he discovered Hutnyk's truth. And the basis for that was the economy. So he believed that by taking into account the economy and set up his grand theory, he can explain and predict on how the world spirit will begin to David's term. And I don't agree that he had an implied reader, especially if we are talking about the capital, about the capital. There are other works, of course, which are more accommodated for the wider audience, but I don't think that the capital was one among them. And to support my claim, while reading some Marx letters to Engels, he was such a paranoid. Yes, he told them, so sending the money, sending the money. I'm just close, just about this close.
Yeah. He said that for nearly 15 years, he was saying that, yes.
No, don't get me wrong, I'm a Marxist, and I wrote my PhD thesis on problems of Marxist theory today, but I found this interpretation of implied reader not so well found, yeah.
Well, I would disagree, because of course Marx wants to be read eventually. He's not keeping the book under wraps. He carries it himself to Germany and finally does release it. I mean, yes, he's got a problem with finishing, you know, that was clear, and he starts to rewrite, but he's rewriting it. I will ask you back, yeah, why does he rewrite for the French edition? Why does he change it, you know, if not with the readers in mind? And he says explicitly, he says he's writing that first section because that will give the most difficulty to the readers, because... Well, what goes on in that first section is interesting. Right? There are four, first chapter, the condensation of the earlier book from 1859. He has the divara, the first section, the commodity. Then there's the second section, which is on the two aspects of the commodity. You know, it has a double existence, then the money form, the exchange form expanded, you know, cotton to linen, coat, apples and oranges can all be calculated in terms of equations, and then the section where he talks about the commodity fetish. Right? Now these four parts of the text, according to Nicole Pepperell, who's said interesting things about it, is staged voices. Of what the political economists, Ricardo and the Haley-Brief professors and so on, are saying. And then comes Marx's analysis, where he forces the secret of the production of surplus value, the economy stuff that you're mentioning. Right? Why then, if not with a reader in mind, with an implied reader, does he rewrite first of all, for the 1867 version, The Critique of Political Economy. Why not bring that forward? Why does he rewrite so quickly after publishing in 1867 the thing for the French workers? I think the Gaethje Spivak's commentary about the implied reader is important. This text is written for a political figure. And that has changed, of course, because it's 150 years ago, but it's still those of us on the left, I would hope, that we read ourselves into that position. Oh, yes. Anything else? Anything back on that?
So yeah, then in the second tome of The Capital, you have some of Marx's economic formulas, which I think he even lost it, that he didn't even knew what to say anymore about it. So I don't think that his theory regarding economic formulas to explain something was founded. What I believe he was good. He observed very good. Second, he was a good compilator. He used Ricardo's theory, he used Smith's theory, and then combined both of them, took what's good, left what was wrong. But when he got into his economics formulas, he lost it. That's my opinion.
Okay, so yeah, that's interesting. But I think there's this kind of rushing to judgment that's there in that. Is there something I want to go a bit slower then, rather than making, you know, judgments about whether the formula is true or not true or something. The idea of the what you do with this book is to bring out the tools of analysis that allow us to make sense of this monstrous thing called capital now. And those tools are unfold through this book. Its mode of presentation different to its analysis, but the analytical tools are there for us to work with, right? He's expecting a reader that will do this, that will take up his discussion of, for example, I mean, let's go from the back, because I like sometimes to read the book backwards or something just to tamper with the things and do a bit like Frederick Jameson does. I think, first of all, about the lumpen proletariat. And the important notion that's offered there, and the different parts of the stagnant, latent, and floating population of underemployed or unemployed workers that are used to keep wages down, to ensure that the part of the working day that can be appropriated by the owner of capital will be greater than that which is apportioned to the worker as wage to keep them alive. Now, other workers, non-working workers or underemployed workers or women and children or the floating population and so on, this is a really useful concept. Whether it's true for Dickensian London in 1854 or whenever, 1863, when Marx is writing that particular section of Capital, isn't really as important as whether this question of the unemployed and the migrant worker, the latent and the floating population of workers, has analytical purchase today. And I think it still does. We have to read it differently in the current context. But the tool is useful. I mean, the unemployment is a weapon used against employed workers to keep them ducking and diving, to keep them anxious, to keep them worried about, you know, stepping out of line, losing their privilege in work, right? This is the precarious, I mean, Marx's term is precarious worker that I believe was discussed yesterday, although I wasn't here for that.
But you can use Hegel's philosophy to explain. I mean, after all, Marx was Hegelian. Why use Marx's theory to explain? You can use Hegel's dialectics and explain.
Well, Marx will say that his dialectics is the opposite of Hegel's. It is not, he's gone through what's called the fiery brook, the discussion of Feuerbach and terrible image again, coquetting, put Hegel back up on his feet after Feuerbach had put him on his head or something, right? There's a great book by a guy called Zawa Hanfi called The Fiery Brook, published in discussion and debate with the Althusserians. So marked with its time, 1972, I think. But it's a translation of The Essence of Christianity by Feuerbach. But his preface, talking about to what degree is Marx's analysis and what degree is his presentation Hegelian, is really important. And he makes a good distinction, I think, between the presentation being Hegelian, but the analysis being something very critical of Hegel. And I think that's in the record, and that's why it's useful. Of course, in that debate, he's debating... Zawa Hanfi is debating with the Althusserians, who make this split between a kind of humanistic Hegelian Marx and science Marx, right? And he's arguing for a more continuous version of Marx that I find sympathetic. You know, the Althusserians, in terms of where you start reading Capital, were interesting themselves. You know, they said, read it line by line. I'm kind of doing that. But they also said, skip chapter one, read the rest, and then go back, which is very strange. Right? But Jameson, in his recent book, he says chapter one and chapter eight aren't really part of the book. The real key to the book, which is about underemployment, are the sections on the working day and technology and cooperation, division of labor, and lumpen probably talk about tomorrow night. Section eight, the bit that both Harvey and Jameson say is a kind of outside the book as a coda, and which Marx wrote first. Primitive accumulation, so-called primitive is a bad translation, unbekannte, originary accumulation, is crucial for how capital works today. It's a tool for understanding the current imperial conjuncture.
Now, I have one more question. Do you find it important when presenting Marx to present Moses Hess, for example? Are you familiar with him?
Not so.
Well, he was the collaborator of Marx in the Rheinische Zeitung.
Yes,
and for example, he wrote not so well familiar book, but I presented to my students a few weeks ago. It was Cambridge translation of The Whole History of Mankind. It is a socialist reading of Bible. And in the conclusion part of the Hess work, you can find that Marx and Engels literally copy-pasted few things in their work of Communist Manifesto. And I believe that Moses Hess pretty much influenced Marx and he was one who influenced him of his contemporaries, mm-hmm. So I find it important, at least when presenting Marx's work, to present Moses Hess also.
And Wolff and many others, I think, you know, yeah. There's a collaboration. I'm not so concerned about what in those days was cut and paste, you know. Was it really cut and paste? Did they have to rewrite, handwrite everything out and so on? But yeah, this kind of, as I point out, the first sentence is Marx doing cut and paste of his own text. I think there's a lot to be done, although that really requires an even more obsessive, nerdish, scriptural obsession than mine, right? And you can get this excellent volume, strange volume, three volume set actually by Hal Draper, which is kind of like a phone book for the people who are named in Marx's work, and it gives their background and history, the quotations and citations, the references, and all the possible publications. It's really like it must have taken ages to compile these volumes. They were done in the 70s, but they are a really great resource and for digging out Moses and Wolff and Feuerbach and obscure people, even the so-called learned professors of political economy that Marx is critiquing, because remember, it's a critique of political economy. And he has individuals in mind. I'll talk about this tomorrow as well. He has the professors of political economy from Haileybury College, where the officials of the East India Company were trained. And he hates them. He thinks they are real apologists. And he calls Macaulay a falsifier and a sycophant. And it's really interesting to look up. For me, it's really interesting to look up these, who influenced who and what is the biography and so on. Does it help us with the purchase of an analytical condition of our time? Yes and no, maybe, I don't know. There's an open reading of the book that I think can be at least pushed at or hinted at when we recognize that there's this weight of pre-determining prefaces and interpretations and so on that we can't avoid. We cannot not read them. We cannot not have them working on us, and yet at the same time our desire is to read the book and take something from it for our own analysis. And to do it not individually is like some kind of, you know, become a professor of Marx in a university. To do it in a collective project is the other side of that story.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Anything you like, I'm prepared to witter. Yeah.
Ask a question.
Thanks. I'm actually interested in the Gothic aspects of Marx. It is very popular now in literary studies. I don't know when it actually began. This kind of reading through this Gothic lens, was it from the start? Or I noticed that in your wish to retranslate the word differently to encompass this Gothic kind of sense to it. And like you mentioned the specter, and Marx mentions vampires and dead labor and everything.
Werewolves.
Yeah. But is it like maybe overinterpretation? Like we're trying to put like this Gothic element almost in every word that could be translated a bit differently to encompass this this feel of of Gothicism. So I don't know.
It can go too far.
Yeah.
But not too far at the same time. Again, I want to have this double bind, right? I think it's been really useful that, yeah, especially since Derrida's Spectres, that there's been a tension, and in the early 2000s again, especially, the vampire of, you know, zombie capitalism is a title you see from especially the Trotskyite left in England again. I'm sorry I keep on going about them, but they upset me so much. They're not friends like those. No, who needs capitalists? This is a great Gothic text, and you'll see Marx got this one out, and volume two he didn't prepare for publication, and it's dry and it doesn't have literary references. It doesn't refer to any, you know, Dante's not there and so on. And the footnotes don't denounce ugly money bags and the usurer, and there's no anti-Semitic. Well, there shouldn't be any anti-Semitic stuff, but there kind of is, because, you know, the Shakespeare isn't there, right? Does that help the reader? Sometimes it does. Does it help the reader, whoever the reader is, for us to now point to it, right? Yes and no, because I think it's useful at one point to say, hey, look at this book. You can read it differently again if you read it through the Gothic, or if you read it through Robinson Crusoe and so on. Or again, what I'm not just doing an ad for tomorrow, but I want to read it through India, through Marx's troping of India, because he spends 10 years as a journalist for the New York Herald Tribune, the largest circulating daily newspaper in the United States, and he was their highest paid correspondent, writing about India, Crimea, Ireland, colonialism. Right? And you can, like, instead of going for the Gothic and the zombie and the vampire, you can read it through slavery and India and colonialism and his letter to Lincoln with the International Working Men's Association and so on. That's also good. But these are provocations to read the book in different times, and that's why they're useful. If they become determinant or scripture or how the book should be read, I think they become less useful, in fact counterproductive. So, you know, you don't want this book to vanish into literary studies departments somehow, or into philosophy, or into anthropology departments or something like that. But to go to those metaphors and tropes and look for those translation issues and so on, if that's a way to re-enliven our use of the concepts and tools, that seems to me like a great thing. Too easy just to say zombie capitalism, we are the walking dead, and you know, I mean, that is a fetish form as well, you know? And so I think their Spivak's critique of Derrida for going to the spectres, where she says she's very happy that Derrida returned to Marx, but also says, when did you stop reading Marx? And is very critical, and they fell out over this, is also powerful, because she shows that by focusing on the spectre, especially of his 10 plagues, you know, this in Spectres of Marx in the middle, I think it's the Wears and Tears chapter, he has an analysis of 10 plagues of contemporary society, and they are each spectral. They are these, you know, nefarious drug cartels and the mafia and the pharmaceuticals. They all rely on spectrality. They don't rely on the key economic analysis of Marx that reveals the workings of industrial production. She points out, and she shows convincingly, I think, that Marx does not have, that Derrida does not have a conception of industrial production, that he is talking about mercantile capital. And he hasn't recognized that unfolds in this book. And it unfolds more in volume 2 and volume 3. The distinction between mercantile capital, capital by trade, and the expropriation of surplus value through paying the worker less than the worker produces, right? And that there's this extra premium coming with technology and cooperation and having a reserve army and so on. That is the secret of, or the secret, the so-called, is the analysis of the capitalist mode of production. Industrial production is different to mercantile trade, and the Shakespeare stuff keeps Derrida in the land of mercantile trade, because his examples are The Merchant of Venice and so on, usury and debt. The book, Spectres of Marx, is subtitled Debt and the Work of Mourning and the International. Yeah. He doesn't really get to the international, he just has this idea that there will be an international of people who have some kind of debt to Marx, but his 10 plagues have no debt to Marx, to Marxist analysis. So yes, useful and not useful. Zombie and not zombie. Yes, watch the zombie films, but remember they are films.
Yeah, but
they're not real zombies.
I know, but like Marx is used as this connection point between the state of capitalism today and this resurgence of zombie films and vampire movies that are happening right now. And it's like Marx is he's used to explain why are we seeing so many zombie films and so many vampires like entering our popular culture in this particular stage of capitalism? So what
I'm slightly worried by the dominant tendency now of philosophers always reaching for a film for an illustration of an analytical point. He says in this conference with pointed reference to, I don't know, Hitchcock or something. But at the same time, yesterday in Rijeka, I was talking about Citizen Kane as a tool to talk about how this book and its commentary on crisis and debt and austerity is very contemporary. But you can think about the films with Michael Douglas, Wall Street, and The Wolf of Wall Street as kind of another phylum, if you like. Instead of the zombie films, you have Wall Street films, and they are again a fetishized representation of things that we need to analyze, let's say. I mean, watching the film does not give you the purchase, critical purchase that we need to make a political movement that destroys this austerity, that moves us to plan C, not just plan A, austerity, plan B, fighting against austerity, but plan C, building the other society through care and through community.
You mentioned you touch upon chapter 10/8 and the sexist aspect of Marx before, but we didn't really get to it, so I was wondering if you maybe want to make a short comment.
Why is it that Marx thinks that Mrs. Kugelmann should start with chapter 8 in the German, in chapter 10? They divide chapter, the English translation divides chapter 4, or maybe it's 5 up differently, so their numbering gets out of sequence. And by the end, we have 36 chapters in the English and only 28 in the German or something like that. I would just be generous and say, you know, that's Marx being of his time, and it's problematic, and let's move on from that and recognize that Mr. Kugelmann needs to start with chapter 10 as well, because it's his kids that are being drawn into, you know, Dete Fabula Narrator. This story is told of other people, but it's really you that should be interpolated into this. This is what the factory system will do to all of us, because it imposes a monetization of more and more parts of our lives. And isn't that the analysis that the wages for housework people and Silvio Federici and Leopoldina Fortunati and those people are pushing forward, that housework, care work, everything that was supplement to the wage, to the male wage, in the olden days, let's say, was already breaking down in Marx's time, and Marx was analysing it. Engels as well in 1844 was paying attention to this, already was analysing that. And still we are kind of having battles about monetization of the household economy. You know, we pay people to cut our hair now, and monetization of all parts of our lives. It's not just domestic work. I have a little device in my pocket that calculates every conversation I have to the second in terms of a cost. Right? It's called a mobile phone. But they measure my conversations and have monetized even that. My friends are all monetized now by Zuckerberg on Facebook. Right? All right, they're not really my friends. They're my friends. And, you know, there are 3,000 of them or something. It's ridiculous because, you know, I don't have, you know, lucky if I've got 4 friends, but the thing that the working day chapter does, you know, it's a really crucial chapter, that chapter, and I think it's worth starting with that one. I mean, I say to people now, start at with the last chapter, sometimes just for fun, because I spend too long on the first sentence, right? But the chapter 10 would be a good one to start with, even though I've warned not to and said it's because it's the hinge of the book. Marx sets out the really important concepts of use value, exchange value, absolute surplus value, relative surplus value, right? It's the concepts that he's going to need, right? But they're set out in this I think, quite austere way. And then he launches into a long meditative chapter, which starts for the first time with the voice of the worker. You know, we should look at it. Let's look at chapter 10, the working day. You know, so why I was using Citizen Kane yesterday, we were talking about whether or not you need a named capitalist to be a personification of the class category. Marx says that any of the capitalists that he names are just personifications of a class category, even though he's really insulting about some of them, you know, and he calls them money bags and so on. He really means this is a class category. But then I was saying, well, is Kane, Citizen Kane, a kind of emblem, or Bill Gates or someone like that, are they emblems of this class category and so on? But up until chapter 8, chapter 10 in the English, there's been no voices except for the capitalist. The capitalist has laughed when he brings the worker into the factory and says, I will pay you a fair day's wage for a fair day's work. And the worker says, that sounds fair, but the capitalist laughs because the capitalist owns the excess, the surplus that that worker, despite being paid fair, so-called fairly. So the capitalist has had a voice, a speaking part in the drama of this book. You know, it's a staging of this set of relations. The theatrical is really strong. That's part of the Gothic, actually. This Gothic book is also a theatricalization of class relations in some way. And so there are voices that come on stage. And in at the start of the Working Day chapter, he says, just after the vampire bit, actually, it's on page 342 in the English. Right, so it's the third page in on the Working Day. Capital is dead labour, which vampire-like lives only by sucking living labour, and lives all the more that it sucks. The time during which the worker works is the time during which the capitalist consumes the labour power he has bought from him. And so both the worker and the capitalist here are, in German it's less obvious or bad, I would say. If the worker consumes his disposable time for him or herself, he or she robs the capitalist, right? The capitalist therefore takes his stand on the law of commodity exchange. Like all other buyers, he seeks to extract the maximum possible benefit from the use value of his commodities. Suddenly, however, there arises the voice of the worker. First time it appears at the beginning of this chapter. The voice of the worker, which had previously been stifled in the sound and fury of the production process. Great image, this clanging, horrible factory sound and so on, but finally stands up. Eight chapters in, chapter 10 in English, the worker stands up and speaks for three pages about the injustice of being paid at this rate for this productive activity. Okay? And then the chapter moves from this complaint to document then the struggles against this situation, the struggles against the factory being more and more proletarianized, the workers become de-skilled because of machinery and replaced by less expensive workers, which are women and children, and the descriptions of children, especially in this chapter, are harrowing, harrowing stuff. And it's kind of like, it's a different character, this chapter. The chapters before were, except for the Robinson bit and the table bit, pretty dry and economic, and there was formulas and so on. But this is like the ethnographic chapter. This is, and it's about the voice of the worker who is individual at the start of the chapter, but by the end of it, the workers have put they have knocked their heads together into a collective and fought for the 10-hour day. This chapter could stand alone as a separate book. I think it should come out as a separate book, right? No, it shouldn't. You should get the whole thing. But it could have stood as a separate section in the same way, I suppose, that Engels' 1844 Condition of the Working Class in England book is, in fact, Marx thinks of himself as updating, in this chapter, updating Engels' Condition of the Working Class. When Engels comes to release the Condition of the Working Class after Marx is dead, he doesn't change a thing. He just references and says, but, you know, I'm not updating this book because in chapter 10 of chapter 8 of Capital, Marx has already done so. Right? But the drama of that chapter, I want to pay attention to that as a structure, the plot of this chapter. It goes from the capitalist is there, arises the worker's voice, and then through a long period of struggles against the 10-hour, the legislation of the 16-hour day and the 14-hour day, and then the education acts, and with the alliance with the person who should never be forgotten in any discussion of this chapter, the factory inspector, Leonard Horner, whose name should go down in the annals of proletarian history, Marx says, as you know, a champion of the working class, although there were problems with Leonard Horner. He was a factory inspector. He went to inspect the factories in accompanied by the capitalist owner of the factories and wined and dined and flirting with his daughters and so on. So, you know, his perspective on it was sometimes problematic. I've been reading his diaries, his letters and diaries, very interesting. But through this very detailed long chapter of all these struggles and the factory inspectors and the reports and the parliamentary debates and the excuses of the capitalists why they shouldn't have kids having just 2 hours a week of education, right? And then they can kind of concede that because they see that having these kids a little bit trained up is useful for them. And so by the end of it, Marx is saying, it's the last section of the chapter, the cooperative societies have emerged. There's been the eight-hour agitation. There's a reference to the Civil War and the Working Men's Association rights to Lincoln. And Marx says labor in the white skin cannot emancipate itself. Where in the black skin, it's in chains. And then the worker has emerged through this struggle, this process over 60 years or something. And the second last page. It must be acknowledged that our worker emerges from the process of production looking different from when he entered it. In the market, as owner of the commodity labour power, he or she stood face to face with the owner of commodities, one owner against the other owner. The contract by which he sold the labour power to the capitalist proved in black and white, so to speak, there was free exchange. But he was forced to sell it. Next page. In fact, the vampire will not let go. The vampires come back. See, it's planned, the drama of this chapter. Vampire at the start, vampire at the end. It's like good plotting of a novelist. The vampire will not let go while there remains a single muscle, sinew, or drop of blood to be exploited. But for their protection against the serpent of their agonies, the workers have put their heads together, zusammenrotten, as a class, and they compel the passing of a law, an all-powerful social barrier by which they can be prevented from selling themselves and their families into slavery and death by voluntary contract with capital. In the place of the pompous catalogue of the inalienable rights of man, there steps the modest Magna Carta of the legally limited working day, which at last makes clear when the time which a worker sells is ended and when his own time begins. Quantum mutatis ab illo. What a great change from what was before Virgil. So the Gothic there, the literary, the drama of the text allows the staging of a political mobilization. And man, that's an important place to start this book. That is the politics that were erased in that bad translation of the first sentence. The anger and the need to get those workers to read and see through this trick of fair day's wage for fair day's pay and organize. I can't stress that more. It's so crucial that it seems right to start with that chapter, the working day. And then after it, the chapters become more circumscribed. They're different parts of the analytical operation we need. They're about division of labor, cooperation, technology, lump and proletariat, historical antecedents, colonialism. You know, they're almost like they're important, but once you've got this working day thing, you know why you're going to need these tools, because you've got a project. That's why I think it's a good book for our time.
Yeah, well, I would like now to shift debate from the theory of the book to the praxis of everyday life. And immediately, I find a problem. Can you today detect class consciousness in contemporary society? I will give you two examples. A year ago, I was walking in the center of the Zagreb, and two groups were, let's say, demonstrating. One were elementary school teachers. The second were doctors. They stood one next to each other and they all yelled their demands. Doctors said, we want higher payments. School teachers, we want better conditions. But it seemed to me at least that between them, stood an invisible wall. They didn't detect, which was immediately obvious to someone who is a Marxist, that they are not protesting against, I don't know, Ministry of Education or Ministry of Healthcare. They're protesting against the system as a whole. And I believe that the demonstrations failed precisely because of their inability to unite as the groups who were demonstrating and to detect that they were demonstrating against the whole society. Second example, I went to a cultural event of classical music in Croatian Music Institute. I didn't know at that time that it was a humanitarian or so-called humanitarian event. I came, and after I came, I saw that there were banker elite, and there were...
Sorry, I didn't understand. There were...
There were bankers elite, from okay. People from the bank. Yeah. Yeah. And the orphan kids and the kids from the well-off families. The other audience was common people, yeah. The children sang to the banker elite. They sang to the same people who made them orphans, who made them well-off. I immediately turned around me to see the common people, common audience, and they were clapping their hands after they performed their song. Now, can we put today the Marx concept of class consciousness and see where it leads? Or is there something like what I like to call new class ontology, which I can't define at the moment?
Yeah, we have to be kind of precise about what we mean by class. We're talking about cultural class, class ascription, status, and so on, and class consciousness in a Marxist sense, which is something different. And you know, it's a problem that in the beginning of the manifesto we have a binary model of class presented. But if you instead look to the 18th Brumaire, you see a very more nuanced assessment of all the different class forces, and further in volume 3 of Capital, you'll see that maybe not the bankers, but the managers of capitalist organizations are becoming somehow proletarianized. Marx is talking about that. They become mere administrators. And we can make an analysis of what is happening there in terms of positioning of this, everything, the growth of petty bourgeois sensibility within our institutions, so that in universities now we are basically something like cheap salesmen selling degraded goods at biggest knockoff prices, you know, and growing more and more the service sector administration of the university because it's a branded thing, you know, the massive increase of this malignant and parasitic bureaucratic class in our institutions and so on. And this has also happened in the banks. And I have no sympathy for the bonuses and these bastards are getting, you know, money that, but I'm not going to come with some kind of sports cars for all. We should all enjoy those kind of riches because of the economic distribution of you know, privilege and so on. But there's, the question is a different one when we start to talk about class consciousness, and this is what the implied reader kind of stuff is about as well. What is it that can reconcile this vast difference between the divisions that are made amongst us, between these kids that are merely entertaining these privileged bankers, or worse, in a city like where I'm from, London, or where I live now, sorry, I'm not from there, but where I live now, lived for nearly 20 years, that we have now the world's largest number of billionaires, right? 84 billionaires has gone up 12 since just last year, right? During austerity, we have 12 new billionaires living in London. There are 84 in London, 102 in Britain. There are only 49 in Moscow, right? And 42 in New York. It's. I'm not doing this kind of 1%. Thing that David Graeber says that he invented and stuff, but you know this separation is a part of a process of that notion of proletarianization, the de-skilling, the making everyone subject to the capital and how capital has monetized every part of our life, whether it be a banker or a kid singing in the street that has somehow been monetized. You know, it's cute, it's on Facebook, I'm sure there are people filming it and they uploaded it and something, and Zuckerberg can get his, you know, little bit of attention capital come from what the Google algorithm provides it. The analysis of this is what we need more than ever. Right? We need to also debate how that shifts and changes as capital, of course, tries to divide and rule and keep people ducking and diving, you know, and looking out for their individual self-interest rather than collective, or feeling that they are, you know, somehow individually mentally ill when, in fact, mental illness is a social problem. Right? Or that we're all anxious because, you know, it's dangerous to send your kids on their own to school, or it's dangerous to send your kids to school, right? Not just to send them, you know, drive them there. Or we're anxious that, you know, housing or debt or, you know, we need to make this a collective analytical project as well. That's what class consciousness will be, not class ascription and you know, the culture of class, like working class or, you know, by clothing. No, it's an exercise I used to set my students for their assignment for my course was for them to write about their contribution to surplus value extraction. As students, as part-time workers, as recipients of benefits, as workers or patients in hotels, where are they in the whole apparatus of surplus value extraction? I mean, if I think about my own role when I was teaching, what do I do? I don't actually produce, in the old university, I didn't produce any surplus value. I contributed to the capacity, the labor capacity of my students who could then later produce surplus value. Now that the university has been turned into a teaching factory by this malignant and parasitic bureaucratic class, yes, maybe I do make a little bit of profit for the owner of the institution because we sell the courses for fees, right? And that's a kind of, you know, value extraction. It's making individuals pay for their own training so the capital can benefit, employ them and profit. And so my contribution is still more contributing to someone else's possible surplus value capacity to labour. It's interesting to think of the way your class consciousness is there when you have... See, by the end of the book, well, by chapter 7 of Capital, Marx is no longer talking about the labour theory of value. Right? It's no longer the individual worker employed by the capitalist. It's an expanded and narrower sense. It's the production of surplus value in the social as a whole. And it's all of the workers together, including the unemployed workers, the floating and stagnant and latent parts of the employment, because they are keeping wages down for those that are in employment for the benefit of capital. Because the surplus value that can be then appropriated and then valorized through the market, if we've got enough people to buy all this stuff, is of benefit to capital. So the class question is one to be really thought through slowly as well, and critically. And it's not just about what shirt you're wearing, you know, whether your trousers or boots are muddy or your hands are calloused. You know, that kind of class is a different thing. I don't know, do you think? Does that sound reasonable or unreasonable?
Yeah, I agree with you. I agree with what you said, yes.
Okay. It's a wrap, is it? Is that a good place to start? Cut. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna. Next is now, right?
No, at 3.
It's at 3? Oh, I thought we had to get out of here. Okay. We can continue. Okay, so in chapters. Yeah.